Sequential Monte Carlo is a group of algorithms that are used by lots of professionals in lots of different fields. So the literature and terminology for SMC is quite confusing. For example, engineers and others often call them particle filters. Luckily for rare event estimation, it all boils down to this identity. The probability that X is greater than gamma is the probability that X is greater than gamma 1 times probability that X is greater than gamma conditioned on being greater than gamma 1, where gamma 1 is smaller than gamma. I'll illustrate the main ideas with the example below. Here we want the probability that M is above the level gamma 1, where X1 and X2 are IID Pareto random variables. Before getting to SMC, let's try to combine the identity above with crude Monte Carlo. This scatter plot shows 100 X1, X2 pairs of Pareto variables. If we take a small threshold, like 0.1, we can make a crude Monte Carlo estimate for the probability of M exceeding this threshold. We just count the number of pairs whose maximum value is above this small threshold and divide by the number of pairs, 100, to get 62%. Now, if we throw away those red points, which didn't make it over our first threshold, we have a sample of X1 and X2 conditioned on their maximum being larger than 0.1. Then with the remaining 62 points, we can look at a slightly better threshold of 0.2. Again, crude Monte Carlo lets us estimate the probability of M exceeding 0.2 when conditioned on exceeding 0.1. And this is the fraction of green points divided by the total of number of points, 62, giving about a 45% probability estimate. Now, if we use the identity I showed on the previous slide, we can make a combined estimate that the probability of M exceeding 0.2 unconditionally is about 28%. As we can see, this process can continue for higher thresholds like 0.3 and 0.5. But eventually we choose a threshold that's too large, like 0.85. and there are no points above it, and our entire estimate collapses to zero. This shouldn't be a surprise, because the estimates we are producing are exactly crude Monte Carlo estimates, and CMC usually fails when looking at rare events. In fact, if you look carefully, when these individual estimates are combined, the fractions all cancel out with each other. So there's literally no benefit to doing exactly what I've shown here. However, if we add a few modifications to this procedure, we get to a sequential Monte Carlo estimator. Now we will watch a real sequential Monte Carlo estimation algorithm working. We start by simulating some number of IID X1 X2 pairs, just as before. Here, I have 50 pairs so that the plots don't go crazy. And we estimate the probability of exceeding a small threshold of 0.13 with a simple CMC fraction. Right here, there's already a small difference from the previous algorithm we looked at. The threshold of 0.13 was chosen by the algorithm so that a pre-specified fraction of points would be on either side of the boundary. Here I have set the threshold so that half of our points are on each side of the boundary. We again throw away the points which were too small, and now we moved on to the key step of the SMC algorithm. We now only have 25 points, whereas we'd like to have the full 50 points we started with, all IID samples from the original distribution conditioned on M being greater than 0.13. How do we do this? MCMC is the answer. We take one of the 25 green points and start a Markov chain from that location. After the Markov chain is run for a number of steps, here I believe I let it run for 50 steps for each chain, And then we take the value of the Markov chain as a new point in the next iteration of SMC. Here, I've shown the starting and ending position for a few specific particles when each is pushed around a bit by their own MCMC chain. And finally, here are the start and end positions after we do this 50 times. In this example, I started with 25 pairs and I want to end up with 50 pairs. So I start two MCMC chains from each green point and then I end up with the desired 50 points. This explains why there's two arrows leaving some green points. Actually, as I'm starting two chains from each green point, you might be wondering why there aren't two arrows going away from every green point to blue points. Remember that with a simple random walk sampler, we create proposal points and either accept them or reject them according to some probability. Well, it's possible to reject every proposal, so that after this process, some points don't move at all. And possibly we even have duplicate points, since both Markov chains failed to move from their starting position. This isn't ideal. Anyway, we now have a sample of 50 pairs which are approximately distributed, like the original distribution, conditioned on having m greater than 0.13. FYI, most of the literature would call these x1, x2 vector samples particles, and the collection of them is a population of particles. We repeat the same process as before by finding a new threshold, 0.2, so that about half of our points are on each side of the threshold, and we have the probability estimate that m is greater than 0.2 is about 25%. We throw away the small points, and we regenerate the whole population using MCMC. So that we end up with 50 points, which are approximately distributed like the original distribution, conditional on m being greater than 0.2. This process repeats until we get an estimate for the rare probability that we care about, the probability that m is greater than 1. One minor thing to keep in mind is that sometimes we won't be able to find a threshold that exactly splits our population in half. This is because the MCMC regeneration step has not worked 100% perfectly, and we have some duplicate points. For example, here with the intermediate threshold of 0.49, we only get 24 particles over this boundary, and our probability estimate should reflect this minor deviation from our pattern. Also, when we generate 50 particles from the surviving population of 24 particles, we'll have to resample most particles twice, but some particles thrice. I believe it's important to make the selection of those 2 and 3 times sample points randomly. The MCMC did a pretty good job of mixing here, since a lot of particles managed to travel from the top left region of high probability all the way around the grey boxed boundary and to the bottom right region. If we don't choose our parameters carefully, the random walk sampler will begin to struggle to accept proposals that travel such a long distance when our thresholds become very large. Eventually, we get to a point where we can finally estimate the rare event of interest. Inside of SMC land, there are lots of different variations and options available to you. So I'm not trying to say that this is the one and only correct way to do SMC. I'm just showing you one option for SMC. This particular SMC algorithm is actually biased. It produces overestimates of the rare event probability on average, which for the sake of risk management is usually better than underestimating the rare event probability. The algorithm is consistent, meaning that it would return the perfect answer if the number of points in the population was infinitely large. One can create an unbiased SMC algorithm pretty easily by choosing the sequence of intermediate thresholds up front and not letting the algorithm determine them adaptively. Or one can add a correction term to remove the bias, and the details of this and many other things are in the paper I've linked on our course website.